Aloha and welcome to Island Connections. I'm Ibrahim Aoude. Faculty and the state is tonight's topic for discussion. And with us we have two UPA board members, University of Hawaii Professional Assembly, that's the faculty union, and Naoko Shibusawa from history, and Jeannie Lam from education. And you are both board members, and welcome for you to come and share your views with us. Could you tell us something about what you do at UH as a professor and also at UPA as a board member?
Well, I teach U.S. history in the history department at Manoa. I teach U.S. foreign relations and the U.S. survey. And I'm on the UPA board, and I'm also in a couple of, well, several committees. I'm on the organizing committee, and I'm on the women's committee on the UPA, in UPA.
And I am in the Department of Educational Foundations, and I teach philosophy of education is my background. I teach philosophy of ed, and also some courses for teacher preparation, some foundation courses for teacher preparation at the college. What else? I've been on the UPA board for 2 years, and I was a faculty rep beforehand, and I'm a member of the grievance committee as well, and I'm also a member of the Hawaii Educational Policy Center.
All right. Yeah. So we just want to say, like, there is an impending faculty authorization for strike for UPA. So we want to know, like, what are the main issues in terms of the contract that UPA is trying to negotiate with the state now? Naoko, you want to?
Well, I mean, we've negotiated everything except for salary. And the union has asked for a 6-8 increase. And just about everybody agrees that we deserve a salary increase. The governor has said it publicly. The BOR has said it. President Dovell has been talking about it. People in the state legislature have been saying that UPA deserves, I mean, not UPA, but UH faculty deserve more money. And yet the governor came back with us with a 0-2 offer, which is pretty insulting and unacceptable to us. And therefore, we're thinking about, you know, going on strike to show her that this is completely unacceptable.
Yeah, so why is it important then to have this strike authorization vote, Jeannie, do you think?
Well, it's actually a legal formality. We have to have the strike, well, you mean this intent or the
authorization,
actually?
Yeah, the strike authorization vote. We're going to vote for strike authorization, yes or no.
Right.
So what is your position on that first, and why is it important to have that position, do you think?
You mean whether I'm for it or not,
yeah,
or against? Well, it's important to have it so that we have all the faculty's views, for one thing, and truly include how everybody feels about it, and it's a vote, you know, of a majority of all the faculty who do vote. I don't want to strike. I don't think anybody wants to strike, obviously, but I think if we have to, we definitely should and will.
Yeah. Okay. What we're going to do now, I interviewed Dean Aligado, and he gave a general picture about the UPA position and also in regards to other unions. So when the footage is ready, we can look at it.
What's happening right now is that meetings are being held throughout the state, throughout all the campuses, to discuss with the faculty the proposal of the board of directors to go on strike in the event that the governor and the the governor's negotiating team refuses the offer that UPA has put forward, which is 8% retroactive to last year and another 6% for this upcoming year. They've been meeting, especially since the counter offer is 0 and 2, which sort of seems like it's baiting the union to do something about it. Now, there are other contracts that are going on, you know, negotiations. So the first one to settle, I was just reviewing prior to this, is UPW. And they settled for 5% this year and 5% next year. So a lot of other public workers' unions, including HGA and us in UPA, are looking at that as a base starting point.
So here, you know, Dean Aligado is talking about, you know, other unions and how if, for instance, United Public Workers negotiates, then that would be like a basis for us to negotiate again with the governor. But why do you think the governor, since she agrees that UPA and the faculty should have more money, why is she doing what she's doing? Naoko or
Jeannie, what do you think about the governor? If we knew, that would be great if we understood why. We're not quite sure why she's doing this, and we have to say that we're deeply disappointed. I mean, we endorsed her twice, and that, you know, we don't understand. I mean, she's made these promises to us and gave us all these reassurances and things about how important UH is for the state economy as a generator of you know, monies and income and things like that. And so we're not quite sure. And, you know, we even heard, didn't we hear at the faculty forum that she's thinking about giving herself and her staff an 18% increase. And she's, you know, this is, we're the union who endorsed her. She's offering us a 0.2, and she's turning around and giving herself and her staff more money, which we found quite outrageous. And so we're not quite sure what the governor is thinking, to tell you the truth.
Go ahead.
If you look, though, I think at the history of the relations of UPA and the state, too, we've always had to go through this negotiation year after year, and often have gone without contract for, you know, two years or more. And I think, in a way, there's already been some established, in an odd way, an established tradition that this is somehow the way it ought to work. And so there, you get lowballed in the first part of it, and then you sit there, you know, struggling, going back and forth. It's a very abusive kind of, I think, relationship. It plays out to be that way, I think, and it has historically. So it's either, you know, it's a question. I mean, there are issues probably about the economy, you know, given, you know, the state of it is in. But on the other hand, I think there's just this traditional manner in which they approach negotiations with all the unions.
But I remember, like, during the 2001 strike, Governor Lingle, she wasn't governor then, she came on the picket line, you know, so...
came and shook her hands.
Yeah, and then, you know, I wonder now if there would be a strike, suppose, hopefully not, would she be coming to the picket line? So, anyway.
That would be funny. I mean, it's an interesting point that Jeannie brings out, that, you know, we have to be lowballed like this, and we have to be under all this pressure, and we're getting, like, all these questions from our students about whether or not we're going to go on strike, and we have to tell them, well, this is precisely what we have to do to try to maintain the quality of higher public education in Hawaii. And so it would have been so refreshing if the governor matched, you know, or, you know, gave us what we wanted from the get-go, and not have to go through this whole process of lowballing us and waiting and adding all this stress to everybody in the UH community.
Yeah, so we can go about our business educating and learning through our research and so on, rather than stressing out on these kinds of issues. I interviewed Monisha Dasgupta about, you know, the situation with the UPA and the state. And she had interesting things to say about the state economy and faculty salaries as well.
Given that, you know, the projections for the state economy are so optimistic and hopeful, I don't see why the education is being given a short shrift, and there is this discourse of how we have to become a premier research institution and, you know, yet not do anything about our salaries to retain us here and to make this you know, good place for us to be, because I think that when salaries don't go up, faculty morale goes down, so that's a problem.
There's an indirect relationship between faculty morale and salaries going up or down. This also speaks to a number of issues, for instance, like retention, faculty retention, and attracting faculty to come here. Mm-hmm. So could you speak to that?
It is a serious problem. I mean, it's as with any worker, right? I mean, it's not just faculty. If salaries aren't going up or even matching cost of living, it's very difficult for any worker, including faculty, and we are workers. And what's difficult about such low salaries here in Hawaii is that most of us come from, especially those of us who work Manoa, come from the mainland. And we're trying to be here and establish families and all that sort of stuff, but it's so very expensive here that it's very hard to want to stay here as much as you want. You love UH and you think really good things about UH to stay here when you get a tempting offer from the mainland. Mm-hmm. And so it's a loss that UH hasn't been able to deal with very well at all, I don't think.
Yeah. Because if UH, again, as Monisha was saying, it's considers itself premier institution or wants to be a premier institution, at least in the Pacific area, so it should be able to attract, good faculty and good people here to do research and teach students. But if the money isn't there, then no one is going to come, right?
One, the fact is that it is a great institution. There are so many smart faculty here. I'm a fairly new faculty. I only got here in 2000, and I have just loved being here. All the intellectual stimulation I get from my colleagues, especially because I'm interested in Asia and the Pacific. I have such smart colleagues in my department and other departments, and I actually really love working with the local students. The mission of a public education means a lot to me, and so there's lots of really, really good things about UH. UH already is a very good institution. It's like we have to think about how to maintain what we already have and even make it better.
Yeah, right. So from your perspective in education and education foundations, what is happening over there in terms of sentiments in regards to how much funding the university or even your college gets?
In particular with College of Ed? Well, I think I think all educators have a very big heart, and I think many of them are extremely stressed by the fact that, that students are going to suffer. And that's one of the issues, I think, that they've attempted to divide faculty with and having them weaken efforts along the strike line. But I think there's some people who, obviously, there's those who just support it wholeheartedly, and then there are some who are hesitating because of these kinds of issues.
Yeah.
With students suffering.
Yeah, good. We are live on the air, and we got our first call from Joyce from La'ie. So you're on the air, Joyce.
Yes, I have a question. I didn't, really know that you folks were thinking about going on strike, except for a couple of ads that I saw in the newspaper. And I was wondering, why isn't your union being more aggressive about informing the public about your situation? I was looking in the paper on last week, Sunday, and the Ameron workers the cement workers would make an average of $71,000, a medium salary of $71,000, and the Hawaiian cement workers make a medium salary of $85,000. And I think our professors at the university should be paid a decent salary. Yeah. I don't know if you folks make as much as they do. Even the bus drivers make like $60,000+. So why doesn't your union, show how much you folks are making in comparison to other workers, and show how underpaid you folks are? Because from what I understand, you folks go to school for like 10 years or something to get a PhD, and then you have to constantly, improve yourself and stuff like that. And what is the median salary of the professor in comparison to the blue-collar workers?
Yeah. Well, to put it concretely, talking about the question of salaries, et cetera, I'll have you answer the question, but I just want to say the median salary for you at for Manoa alone, UH Manoa, 02-03 is $68,665, and so in University of Hawaii Community Colleges is $52,322. So, I mean, this gives you an idea. I think the bus drivers and the cement drivers and cement workers deserve the salary they get. So we should also be as high as, you know, those workers as well. So, but anyway, beyond that, did you want to say something about what UPA is doing to educate or what it needs to do?
I feel that. I think they have to do something better with their ad, because the ad that they have is not very informative.
Yeah, we agree.
You're not going to get public support for your strike if you don't have, you know, information out there that people can easily comprehend and be supportive of.
Yeah, that's true. That's good. But anything else did you want to say, either Jeannie?
I totally agree with Joyce, and thank you very much for your support.
Yeah,
I totally agree.
Yeah, thank you, Joyce.
So much.
Okay,
yeah.
Bye.
Right. I want to go to Monisha's second interview. I did another interview with her, and we talked specifically as to why is this happening. I mean, you know, with education, and so here what she's talking about.
Across the board, at universities on the continent, is this philosophy of privatization, where you bring in soft money and you pay your own salary, and that has become, you know, increasingly a way to survive in the academy. I came from a department where it was in the process of being restructured, where lots of public policy people were being brought in because that's where the money was, and they, you know, didn't do very interesting research, but the research got a lot of money.
Yeah.
And, you know, is that really what we want the university to be? You know, isn't the university supposed to be a place where, you know, all kinds of ideas get full play and not one kind of, research is privileged over the other? So I think that the move towards privatization is extremely dangerous, and we shouldn't be thinking along those lines. Research priorities in terms of funding shifts, right? So all of a sudden we saw that in the 80s there was quite a bit of money for doing research on homelessness, right? And that has shifted. There used to be some money to do research on AIDS. That has shifted. But does that mean that these problems have disappeared?
Mm-hmm.
Of course not. But there is no funding in those areas. So if we become more reliant on funding, then, you know, outside funding, then that becomes a problem in terms of, okay, so we don't do any more research on homelessness and AIDS, but we do more research on, I don't know what the hot topic is, immigration.
Until something else happens.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, I mean, here Monisha is talking about something rather critical. There's this whole shift in the U.S. educational system towards privatization, and the question of having more funds from private sources, not only like federal government, but private sources as well. And that is really, in a sense, well, it brings money to the university, but in another sense it compromises the educational mission and the philosophy of education as well, and becomes like a commodity just like anything else. So would you like to say more about that from your perspective?
I think historically anyway, I mean, all universities have always operated in some way in bringing research funds that help support the university. And in a way, that's, you know, I think many people don't realize, in fact, that we do a lot more than just teach. In fact, we not only teach, but we have to maintain a research agenda ourselves. I think to tie it to funding is a statement about how the economy is and how generally, not only Hawaii's, but also just in general, how universities run themselves. Mm-hmm. I think it's become certainly more of an operation like a business mm-hmm. than it has mm-hmm. in the traditional sense of liberal education. And that's the worst part of privatization,
right.
Is that, in fact, then you start feeding subjects or areas which have high visibility or actually are very politicized as being the things to be interested in, and therefore the funding goes in those directions. But I think Manisha makes an extremely good point that year to year funding does shift, and it's a political issue about what's important now and where should we direct our funding. When the walls came down, you know, there were other issues that came up, and funding was shifted, as we saw, from East-West Center,
mm-hmm.
Completely pulled and directed towards European economies again. So I think you know, it's a question that, and probably an issue that the administration needs to deal with, and figure out how to be more equanimous in terms mm-hmm. of supporting its faculty and all the various subject matters as a whole.
It's not just like the state of the economy, because as we know, we just got this terrific presentation by Paul Brubaker, who is the mm-hmm. chief economist of Bank of Hawaii, and he showed us, much to our surprise, because we keep on hearing how horrible the economy mm-hmm. is here, but he showed us, like, you know, graph after graph after graph, how wonderful our state economy is doing. Mm-hmm. But the problem is that our state budget isn't so great because of corporate tax breaks. Mm-hmm. And so it's a matter of not just how bad our economy is, but of choices that our legislators are making. Mm-hmm. I went to the NEA Higher Ed Conference last year, and I heard a presentation, and this guy said, and I think it's quite true, there's an assault on higher public education throughout the nation. Mm-hmm. It's as we go more towards this corporatized, privatized model. We're losing our mission about the value of public education. And if we keep on going down this road, we're going to end up being like the way we were before World War II, such that it's only really rich kids who are able to go to college, rather than having this broad public mission, so that, you know, that any sort of talented kid with the means and, you know, with the ability should be able to go, I shouldn't just say kid, any student, yeah. mm-hmm. sorry, be able to go to school. And another thing that's changed too is that rather than give the federal government giving grants, they're giving more loans. And that's not so great for students or for the economy, because once they graduate, then they're spending all their money paying interest to banks rather than adding more money and their income to the economy. Mm-hmm. And so it's a really sort of dangerous path that we're going through. And as this guy said, it's like, you know, it's your fault. You keep on electing these Republican legislators who keep on doing this and who believe in this sort of supply-side interpretation of economics, of how that should work. But history has shown, you know, that supply-side economics just simply doesn't work. To give more rich people money does not necessarily translate to more jobs for people.
Yeah. And we've tried that with Reagan, and we built up deficits upon deficits.
Not just Reagan, with Hoover.
Yeah, well Hoover, but in the 80s we tried that, and then now we're trying it again with Bush W. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And anyway, we have a question from an anonymous viewer. What is the potential effect the strike would have on students? Yeah, so. First of all, we don't want to strike, right? Mm-hmm. But then if we have to, we will have to strike. And then again, if that happens, what would be the potential effect on students? Would you want to talk about that?
Sure. I think it would be an inconvenience, but I think it's a misunderstanding to think that students will completely lose out, that is, that they're not going to graduate or that they're not going to be able to somehow make up for some of the time that may be lost. But then, once again, this depends on how long the strike, if it happens, goes. Because in the last strike, 3 years ago, we were able to actually come back and teach the rest of those courses and make up for the lost time. So there were no students actually who lost credits, who lost the ability to graduate. It was, I think, just more an inconvenience to them at that point.
Yeah, and it was a relatively long strike compared to a strike happened years back. Or it was a couple of days, in the early 80s.
Yeah, it depends. I mean, some students were, like, really inconvenienced and not very happy about it. I mean, some instructors took it the wrong way about how to make up. For instance, like, I just changed my syllabus and I didn't make my students responsible for the days mm-hmm. that we lost. I mean, how could I make them do that? Whereas some, I think, professors had their students go on weekends and nights and things like that, which I don't recommend.
These are very thorough faculty members.
Yeah. But at the same time, I think, you know, we need to have students actually join us in the strike. I think it's not a question of that they're the ones who are suffering. I think they should acknowledge really the value of the education that they're getting and really realize the position that the faculty is in, and get behind them, actually, yeah. You know, insist with us, you know, with the government that we should actually get our reasons.
I must say, we in the last strike, 2001, we had tremendous support from the community and from students as well. Right. But what I'd like to do now in answering further to Joyce's question earlier on the air and the anonymous viewer, I want to go to an interview I did with Kathy Ferguson. She is also a member of the faculty union board. We will watch that about educating the public and so on.
We have to educate the faculty, the students. Everybody has to see that when you weaken the university by underfunding it, you hurt everybody. You hurt the students, you hurt the state, you hurt the faculty. Everybody suffers from that. Education is a public good. And I guess here's where I think our moral argument has to be made loud and clear, that in the time of privatization, when we see more and more things spun off from the public into the private, there are certain things that you can't do that with without really harming them. Education is a public good, and the public money has to be used to support it. And one of the things that I think the faculty needs to realize for itself and the public needs to realize is that the faculty bring in over $300 million in grants. I think it's $324 million is the number I got today from President Dobell's recent presentation. That's twice as much as our salaries. So there's already a public-private mix there where we bring in money, much of it private, some of it public, like federal grant money, that already mixes those two. And yet, it's still, I think, morally and pragmatically necessary to continue to support public education with public money.
Yeah, I remember also talking to Kathy after she said, like, education is a public good, which it truly is. I said, but some people think of it as a private good. You know, some people need to be educated, others don't, you know, that kind of stuff. And that speaks to the things that you were talking about, like getting into much debt and then, you know, trying to pay the debt later on and so on. So there's a lot of problems, you know. Involved with that. But this begins to say something about what needs to be done, that UPA needs to do to educate the faculty and the community and the students as well to support us. But there's more than that. Did you want to say something on that?
Well, I just want to say that UPA isn't just the UPA board. UPA isn't just JN, Musto, or Mary Tiles, or John Ratcliffe. That UPA is our membership. And that our members are quite concerned about this this issue, and that they, you know, behooves them not only to find out the facts, because we have given out lots of information on the website and information that we sent to our membership, but also educate too, to talk to the students, talk to other people in the community about the value of, you know, of a public education and making a commitment to public education. Mm-hmm. And the other thing that's a part of this too is, like, you know, commitment to public education at the lower levels too, not just higher ed, but also at the lower level. That's something that Hawai'i State desperately needs to do, I believe.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sure. That's good. I want to also, in terms of trying to answer some of the questions here, and some of the ones that may be lurking in our minds, you know, among viewers and so on, perhaps, is to go to the UPA website. I want to go to the UPA website, and I want to show just a few numbers. And then from there, try to go to, like, table two. There's table two there. When you're ready. Are you ready with it? Table two? No? Okay, table two. You got it? Yeah, right there, and the salaries. Okay, you work on until you get table two. We'll come back to you, because I wanted to get some numbers there to just show people what you know, how low salaries we have. We are even now, after the 2001 strike and the increases, which were hardly anything, we are now in the 30th percentile. Before the 2001 strike, we were in the 20th percentile. That means to say that 80% of other institutions and faculty make more than we do. You know, that's like we are in the bottom, 20%, yeah? And then now, with that increase, we are in the 30th percentile, which is still, you know, to go up to the 50th percentile, we cannot get 0 and 2 as the governor has proposed, you know, in terms of the offer. Even 6 and 8 as UPA offered, I mean, you know, proposed, is not gonna make much headway. Right, we need more to even be halfway to the 50th percentile. And if the UH is a premier institution and wanna be even better, we cannot pay our professors, you know, just like 50% of what, you know, other institutions might be getting, you know. So that's a problem right there.
And isn't it true, because I can't say because I haven't been here that long, that it used to be that UH was up in the 80th percentile? Was that? I read that somewhere.
Yeah,
a while ago. That, and so, I mean, it's not like, you know, that UH has always been underpaying its faculty like that. And that, you know, if it did it before, it can do it again.
Yeah, right. So, we have Kerry from Hilo. And so you're on the air, Kerry. Hello? Kerry?
Yes, I'm here.
Yeah. Go ahead. Mm-hmm.
Yes, I'm watching your program. I'm from Hilo, where I am a high school teacher, and I have a friend who's at a community college level here. And we often discuss the situation regarding our worth, salary-wise, and our worth to society in general.
Right.
And it's a situation, I think, where there is a delay between action and fulfillment in our profession.
Mm-hmm.
We are not a first responder in the eyes of Linda Lingle, where she feels it is more worthy to pay first responders a comparable competitive salary versus people in the educational system, where there seems to be a lag between our efforts and any type of result.
Yeah.
And also there's a matter of economics.
Mm-hmm.
If we, the HSTA, which is 12,000 plus members, is given a pay raise, that would be a huge salary increase for us and a huge chunk of the state budget.
Mm-hmm.
Versus if she were to give her cabinet and her department heads a salary increase, even though it may be a double-digit amount, it would not necessarily be a huge dent in the state financial treasury, so to speak.
Yeah.
So that, it's a matter of economics and, again, one of perception. We are not a first responder. If the police or firemen went on strike, there'd be immediate, tangible results.
Yeah. That's a good point. But let me say something before Naoko and Jeannie say. I would say that we are first responders, especially you guys at HSTA, to the needs of the minds of students. And this is very important because, you know, the mind needs to be, like, responded to in terms of, you know, whatever the student is, you know, inquiring about, etc. The teacher would respond to the student and try to tell him what there needs to be.
Yeah.
So that is very important here in terms of what is the notion of, you know, first responder. We respond to student needs on a daily basis, I would argue. But anyway, Naoko and Jeannie.
I truly believe that public school teachers, especially HSTA members, are on this noble mission, and they deserve much more money than they're getting right now. And also remember, Kerry, that, you know, there's 12,000 of you. If you guys got the money and the salaries that you deserve, what would you do with your money? Would you just let it sit in the bank, or would you spend it? And where would you spend it? You would spend it supporting local businesses and businesses here in Hawaii, and that will generate income for the state.
Or spend it on our students.
Or spend
absolutely.
It on our students, right, absolutely.
Yeah, that's good. Jeannie, did you want to say something?
Yeah, I think especially public school teachers have gotten a short rift, you know, in the past here, but they do spend a lot of their own private money just to keep their classrooms going. And I think educators generally do much more than what is sort of seen, you know, by the public eye. And in reality, we actually are there creating and shaping human beings for now and the future. And a lot of those students are leaving Hawaii, actually, as opposed to wanting to stay, not because I think of what's happening in terms of their everyday life, but any future that they would see here. So I think the relationship, for example, between education and our partnering with the local businesses or with the local community is something that is going on now, and it continues to go on, and we need to have more support for the university to nurture those kinds of relationships and actually develop more of the multiculturalness of Hawaii.
Thank you. Thank you, Kerry.
Okay, thank you for having me on the air.
Thank you. Now we want to go to the UHPA website. We're there, table two, and I just want to show some things with table two. For instance, you look at 2001, 2002 salaries for community colleges, $48,170. And 2002, 2003 salaries, $52,322. And just Hilo, UH Hilo, is $49,890. This is not much to, you know, survive on. So professors also need to, you know, pay the rent, pay the mortgage, you know, to send their kids to public school or whatever school they send their kids to, and so on. So that, you know, requires money. So we don't want to strike, but we should authorize for a strike vote so that we have a better bargaining position so that we don't strike. We, you know,
right.
So then they say, okay, these guys are serious, so let's bargain with them seriously and therefore not to go on strike. Right. So this is important to have this position to for the strike vote.
I also want to point out that that a lot of professors are making less than the money that's on that graph. Like, for instance, every single one of those salaries is higher than the money I'm making annually here at UH.
Yeah. So, yeah, these are, you know, average.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Well, I mean, right. And also remember that is it average or is it median?
Well, median is one of the averages, yeah. Median is half of the people do more and half of the people do more. You know, less than this average here, but you know, that's table two, but just gives us an idea. The other thing, there's another chart that I would like to go to. Let's go to the UHPA website as well. Is it ready? Okay. This is you know, UH average salary percentile ranks by faculty ranks. For instance, you can see even the highest, I think that's, community college, first of all. The highest percentile rank is like, I would say 45%, not even the 50 percentile, you know. But then there is also one, the first column on the UHCC, 20 percentile. This is ridiculous, you know. You look at UHM also, for I think lecturer, it is under 30%. Under 30%. This is ridiculous. For professor, let me see which one is professor. But anyway, whichever one, it's under 50% actually for UHM. There's one that goes to 65 and so on. I think this is. I'm not sure which this is. I can't read it from there. But this gives us an idea, though, as to what's going on. You know, I want to go to another.
Can I just point out one thing about
sure.
that? It sounds like the instructors are doing. It seems like from that graph, I think falsely, that instructors are doing well, and they're not necessarily. It just shows that nationally, instructors are so poorly paid that that even at in UH, they seem to be coming out pretty well, but that doesn't really say much because, you know, they too are struggling to make ends meet.
Right, yeah.
Especially the instructors.
Yeah, because this is like in relationship to the nation. Doesn't mean that the national, the instructors in the nation as a whole are getting paid high. No, this is just, this could be like less than what an you know, assistant professor is doing, and assistant professor is not doing very well either.
Yeah.
We just gave some of the numbers, especially in Hawaii, given the cost of living. You know, it's very important to say that. So thank you for Naoko for bringing that one up. Let's go now to table three. Do you have table three? And that would be the last table we want to look at. And, you know, anyway, I can read some numbers here until we get to the table. For instance, community college professors' average salary, in relationship to peer institutions, peer groups, for community colleges, average salary is 62,000 plus plus a few dollars. The peer group salary, and they have 27 peers, is 65,724. So there is, you know, quite a bit of disparity here. For Manoa, the Manoa average salary for professor now, we're talking about professor, is 86,500. The peer group average salary for 32 peers is 99,544. So like you have 13,000 difference. 13,000 difference, that's a lot of money that the professor can send their kids to school and so on. So this is just to give you an idea as to what is going on. Or if, for instance, we get the salary increases, well, yeah, now we, that's fine because I read some of that. That's okay. But if the salary increases that UPA is asking for, 6 and 8 percent, six for last year and 8 for this year, that wouldn't even put us in the 50th percentile, from the 30th to the 50th percentile. So, I mean, this is really ridiculous in that sense. We have a question here from one of the viewers, Greg. When, before last strike, did faculty get a raise? Do you know when before? I've been here
I wasn't here. Yeah. I came in 2000.
Do you know when? I don't remember, actually.
Well, that's telling, too.
Yeah. I don't remember, but if we did, it would have been like 2% or 3%,
right.
Something
it was,
like
it was,
that,
it
which
was
is
less
nothing
than the
to write home
it was
about.
Even less
yeah.
of the cost of living,
right.
But at least it was sort of a token, 1% or 2%.
Yeah, so mm-hmm. It's nothing, really. But the point is, even with, suppose we've been getting a raise every year, mm-hmm. we're still in the 30th percentile, which is ridiculous, mm-hmm. you know, for a governor to suggest or propose or offer 0 and 2 mm-hmm. if she is really for education. And if she appoints someone who is a state negotiator who really admires education so much so that he is on the board of regents. So he's supposed to be for the faculty, and therefore, to me, him being the negotiator for the state and on the board of regents, seems to be some kind of problem for me. Is he with the state or with the faculty? I don't know. Maybe he has to think about that. Yeah. I'm talking about Ted Hong.
Of course.
Yeah. Okay, so.
One other point just on,
yes,
on the salaries is that, you know, on the mainland every year they're already getting an average of the cost of living at 3.9% a year. Mm-hmm. And that's not even counting raise money. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's just every year, you know, consecutive year getting that amount just as sustaining the yeah. cost of living. Mm-hmm. And we don't even get that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Can I just point
sure.
something out? I mean, we had the salaries up there, and I just wanted to like correct for or show, like tell the public that there's a misconception that some people have that professors maybe work 2 days a week, because we teach, you know, like those of us at UHM have something like a 2-3 or mm-hmm. or 2-2 course load, and to sort of say just or 3-3 course load, but just because we're teaching 3 or 2 classes a semester doesn't mean that we just work on those, you know, we just work 2 or 3 hours a day or anything like that, and that our average work week is, what is it for you, Jeannie? How many hours do you work a week?
Well, 60, 70.
I mean, we work very long hours. And for me, I'm on tenure, which means not only do I have to teach my classes, but I also have to write a book so I can keep my job.
Right,
and that also, you know, takes time, in addition to all the committee work and service stuff that we do. And so it's a real misconception to think that we only work like a day a week or 2 days a week.
Yeah, I teach Tuesdays, Wednesdays, and Thursdays. So, but I don't only work on Tuesdays, Wednesdays, and Thursdays. I work Monday through Sunday. But anyway, what I want to go and I interviewed John Kumura from the Department of Ethnic Studies, and he's talking about, you know, juggling for position, you know, on the thing.
Well, both sides are presenting positions from which they will ultimately compromise. I don't think the faculty will accept a 0-2 proposal that's now on the table. So I think ultimately if there is a settlement, it'll be somewhere between that and what the UHPA has requested of 6 and 8 for the percentage increases over the next 2 years. But they're still jockeying for position too, insofar as we take a authorization to strike vote, and that could be a sign of strength, of faculty support for going on a strike. We're also waiting for, I think, an arbitrated settlement for the HGA union, I believe, and to determine how much they will receive. And that also may determine what the likelihood of UHPA is in obtaining its request.
Yeah, well, good. But before we maybe talk a little bit about this, I got this comment from Tim from Wahiwa. You're absolutely right about what we've been discussing. We have the highest cost of living in Hawaii, and UH faculty have lower salaries than the national average, but that's true for everyone that lives and works in Hawaii. What's so different about your situation? Nothing different, and you should be fighting for a better wage so that we can all have a, you know, decent living, and we can, like, meet the needs of our children and the needs, you know, of or requirements in terms of living in Hawaii. Some people say, well, if you don't like it here, why don't you get the hell out of there, out of here? That would be a terrible kind of position to take, because it's the right of people in Hawaii, Hawaii's people, to live in Hawaii and enjoy it and have good positions in Hawaii. And especially when there is, yeah, and good education, especially when people talking about brain drain, you know. So we want a reverse brain drain, so to speak, where local people would come here and find good jobs. So I encourage you, Tim, to go and fight for a better salary and wages for, you know, you and other people. Yes.
Yeah. Also, though, I think it, there's an issue, a broader issue Tim is raising in just how the government is run here in Hawaii. Mm-hmm. I think one thing Brubaker also pointed out was how Act 221, mm-hmm. and I think the newspaper's Advertiser has published a couple of articles concerning that, how it is really bankrupting the state, and it's been renewed. I mean, it, and there are a number of people who are profiting, and a number of consequences we have yet to see that we may suffer. But I think the larger issue of how things are run in the state of Hawaii, and what people, who is being supported by the state, and as opposed to an economy that solely bases it on tourism and external interests.
Good. Let's go.
Can I add something?
Yeah.
And the crazy thing about Act 221 and, like, the government's support of the venture and Ko'olina is that there's no accountability in there. I mean, it should be linked that, okay, if the public is going to give you a business money, then the public should get some sort of guarantee or some kind of accountability of how many jobs you are creating mm-hmm. for people of Hawaii. And then I was at a meeting in Manoa, a town meeting in Manoa this weekend, and Representative Kirk Caldwell said that there was actually a bill last year in the ledge which tried to make businesses accountable for how many mm-hmm. jobs they created, but it was killed.
Yeah.
It was killed by business, you know, lobbyists.
Yeah, right. No, that's a good point on Act 221, because it's depleting the treasury from all kinds of monies that could be used for better things. But I would like to go to another interview I did with Kathy Ferguson. So we can watch it about enlightened self-interest here.
Enlightened self-interest is a very good thing, and that our students are pretty sharp, and I think that it's possible for us to make a good case to students that it's in their best interest to 100% support the faculty on this for a number of reasons. In the short term, if we had to strike, a strike in which students joined us on the line, students refused to cross the picket line, would have much more impact, not take as long. So strategically, it's in their interest to support the faculty in the short run. But in the long term, it's really in their interest. That when the university is strangled financially, then it hurts the students. That's faculty that don't get hired, that's faculty that leave, because they can't afford to live here, because they're hired away. That's grant money that doesn't come in, which could have given research experience to students, or it could have given them jobs. There's all these, like, what's that called? It's like a domino, you know, where it the snowball goes downhill, and it picks the students up in a lot of different ways. So I think that part of our job is to get students to see the big picture here and realize that it really will serve their interests better if the faculty are also served.
Yeah, so there's a light in self-interest, and again, this is in response to earlier questions and so on, basically in terms of educating the public and so on. But I want to go to another interview I did with John Okamura, and he talking about the question of insufficient funds, etc. We mentioned something about this, but it's important to underscore it.
The state position is always that there isn't enough money or there isn't the money, but the situation has changed dramatically since 3 years ago. There is obviously more money available, but even if they took the position that there's no money, it's a question of priority. Where does the money go that is available? And much of that money seems to go to support the Hawaii Tourism Authority rather than the university, which obviously is substantial dividends for the investment in faculty in particular. I think that the last 3 years have shown the value of that investment insofar as the dollar amount of grants that have been awarded to university faculty has increased dramatically in those past 3 years. And I think UHPA needs to do a better job also of informing the public what that means, because those dollars circulate in our economy insofar as these grant monies are used to hire other staff and faculty who pay taxes. They also provide overhead to the university, substantial proportions from all of those grants that enable the university to provide services and employ other people also.
Yeah, so here are some of the things that we were talking about too, but it is underscored here. And for people who say, there's no money. Well, there is money, and again, what you mentioned about Act 221 right. And so on, yeah.
And also, at this meeting that I was at Manoa, State Senator Brian Taniguchi, who's in, I guess he's the chair of the Finance Committee, right. He said that the ledge is making space in the budget for our increases. Mm-hmm. So that's something to be hopeful for. And so the person that we need to concentrate now is the governor.
Yeah. So she should be our target in terms of pressure, put the pressure on her to deliver a good contract and put her money where her mouth is, so to speak.
Yes, and we would not be happy with something like a 2-2 or a 2-3. We would much rather have something, of course, that's closer to what we asked for, which would only be right.
Yeah, but also in terms the thing to be made is UPA public relations is very important. Okamura talked about it, but I want to go to Okamura again, and he talks about that particular point as well, which I think is very important.
I think the UPA union has to do a good public relations job. They've been having ads in the Sunday paper, and I think that should continue also informing the public of where the university faculty salaries are and compared to our peer institutions, and let them know about our plans such that the education of their children is not disrupted, and try to gain their support. I think the bus driver strike was the one most recently in which there wasn't much public support, but all of us remember being on the picket line and having a lot of community support as people drove by, and that's something we should bank on also.
Yeah, so community support is important, support of students is important, as we have mentioned, but we have to educate the public and the students about it, and we have to educate ourselves, the faculty and our colleagues and so on, because it's important, I think, to strengthen our position. Something I mentioned earlier is to go for to authorize the union to strike, so in terms of the authorization to strike vote, which is going to be in 2-3 weeks from now, right. I suppose we should do that, to have that kind of position, strong position in regards to to the state and negotiations with Lingle and Ted Hong, of course. So that I think is an important thing to say. Yeah, go
it's
ahead.
It's an old adage, you know?
Yeah.
United we stand, divided we beg. Do we want to beg? Actually, we can't even beg. We'll get nothing if we're divided like this. Right. And therefore, we really are urging faculty to vote yes on ratification vote. This does not mean, if you vote yes, does not mean that we will necessarily go on strike.
That's right.
We must look united and strong.
Yeah. The other thing, I mean, we've been talking about the only issue is really money, right, on the table this time. But is it really? And for this, we go to Kathy Ferguson, and she has something to say about that, whether it's about money or not.
A university is a unique institution. It creates knowledge, it educates people, it brings kids to the campus and changes their lives. It is a place where research that can't be done anywhere else is done, and where a kind of mind-expanding culture is cultivated. That's irreplaceable in any society. And so to say that it's just about money, no, it's about maintaining the lifeblood of a university. We cannot hire good people. We cannot keep good people. They can't afford to live here. They're not willing to come in the first place. If we can't be competitive in our salaries, you can't have a higher cost of living than all but two other places on the mainland and lower salaries and expect people to come. It doesn't work. So the idea, it's not sort of, quote, just about salary. Salary is a part of a set of relationships that make a university happen.
Yeah, and I think that's an excellent point, and we should really remember it and educate ourselves about it. You know, money contains in it something more than money. You know, it is everything that Kathy was talking about. And, you know, for someone to say, for instance, the truck driver make, $70,000 and you, professor, make $50,000. Well, bring the truck driver's salary down to the professor's salary. I mean, this is ridiculous. We got to change this mindset to make that, we got to make as much, you know, or maybe more or a little bit less. It doesn't matter. But we have to push things up for all kinds of reasons, including, as you said, the economy. If I make more money, where am I going to spend it? You see, you're going to spend it in the economy. It's good. More taxes, more revenues, and all that. So it's very important. So any final words on the UPA and the state situation?
Well, I think for certainly for faculty, vote yes on the strike vote.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And for students and the community, I think get behind the university. It can be a wonderful place for your children to grow up in, and I think that's where the money is going to.
Yeah.
I just want to say the university is a wonderful place, and let's keep it that way. Let's make it even better, and to vote yes on the ratification vote, because I'll repeat it again, you know, united we stand, divided we get nothing.
Yeah.
So let's try to get something.
Right. Yeah, so Naoko Shibusawa, Jeannie Lam, thank you very much, and thanks for our viewers, and we'll see you again next month. Aloha.